All right, so good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to PH703, Quantum Mechanics Part 1. So we're doing the 37th lecture today. So we have covered a lot of ground so far. In the last lecture, we talked about the angular momentum algebra in terms of these Pauli matrices. And what I explained to you is that what these Pauli matrices correspond to is they correspond to the angular momentum operators for a spin 1/2 particle. Now, at this stage, let me just take a little bit of time to explain a somewhat of a abstract concept, which is a part of a branch of mathematics which is called representation theory. Now, I'm not, of course, going to go into the heavy mathematics. That's not my goal. But this is something that you use all the time, but you don't know that you're using it. Okay. So if you understand this concept, it will help hopefully help you make more sense of the material that we have just covered. Okay, so what is this? What do we mean by a representation? What is a representation? So we have talked about symmetry, right? What are some examples of symmetry? Rotation. Translation, right? These are the symmetries that, and of course, there are also discrete symmetries like parity. I don't think we have talked about these discrete symmetries in our class, have we? I don't think so. Maybe I'm forgetting. Time reversal and others. But I have talked about rotations and translations, right? So a symmetry of a system has a symmetry, right? If there is some transformation under which the system does not change, right? So for instance, if I have, this is my set of coordinate axes, right? And I perform a rotation and I change to some other set of coordinates. Right, so let's say now this is x prime and this is y prime and this is z prime. Right, now I'm in the same laboratory. I'm measuring the same, I'm conducting the same experiment. Changing these coordinates only changes my description of the system, right? So for instance, if I have some, if I'm talking about some point particle which has some coordinate, which is at some coordinate vector r in the first frame of reference, well, in the second frame of reference, the location of this particle doesn't change, right? So this is, it's described by the vector r prime. So r prime has different components because you have rotated the axis, right? But the system itself has not been affected in any way, right? So how do you describe this transformation, right? We describe, how do you go from r prime, from r to r prime, right? We describe this in terms of a linear transformation, with multiplication by a matrix, right? Now, what is the dimensionality of R and R prime? These are three-dimensional vectors, right? By this dimensionality, I guess I should probably say rank instead of dimensionality because I don't want to. Right. And so if this is a linear transformation, then this also has to be a, this has to be a 3x3 matrix, right? And this matrix is an element of the group of rotation, right? SO3. Can somebody please quickly remind me whether I have talked about rotations and SO3 and all in any of my previous lectures? Because it, if I did, it must have been a long time back and I forget.
No, you didn't, sir.
Huh? No, I didn't. Okay. All right. So I'll talk about this because this is very important. So this has to be a 3x3 matrix, right? We can consider a simple example in two dimensions. In two dimensions, again, it's the same thing, but now R prime is a two-dimensional vector. Right? So now this has to be a 2x2 matrix. Right? And in two dimensions, you know that what is the form of the rotations? Rotations are very simple in two dimensions. There is only one parameter, theta, right? This parameter tells you the angle between your old coordinate axis and your new coordinate axis. And that this rotation matrix is also very simple. I think all of you must have seen this before. Cosine theta minus sine theta. Sine theta. Cosine theta, right? This is the rotation matrix, right? Which gives you the old coordinates, new coordinates in terms of the old one. Is everybody familiar with this? If you're not, please raise your hands and let me know.
Yes, sir, we have seen it.
So, and if you want to go from R to R prime, what will you do? You will just invert the transformation. You will just multiply by R inverse. Right? Because you just take this equation, multiply both sides by the inverse of R. Now I can have two such rotations, right? So let me label this matrix by this angle theta, right? I can have two such rotations. I can have R theta 1 and then R theta 2, right? So I can rotate by theta 1 and then rotate by theta 2, right? So what does this correspond to? This corresponds to, so first I'm rotating by R theta 1, right? So to go from R to R prime, I multiply by R theta 1, right? Then I rotate from R prime to R double prime, right? This is going to be R theta 2 acting on R theta on R prime, right? This is the second rotation. And so this can be written as R theta 2, R theta 1, R, right? So you have two rotations, one after the other. Now, it should be possible right? It should be possible to write R double prime in this way, right? It should be possible to rotate directly starting from R to go directly to R double prime and multiply by single matrix, right? And what is this matrix going to be, this R alpha? It is just the product of these two matrices, right? These are matrices, remember. Okay. So these are vectors and these are matrices. So this is matrix multiplication. And this is equal to what? This is equal to R of theta 2 plus theta 1. Right. So if you take this expression and you put in theta 1, and then you take the same expression and put in theta 2, so you get two different matrices. You multiply those two matrices. You should get the same answer if you take this expression and put in as the argument, you put in theta 1 plus theta 2. Right? So this is theta 1, let's say, and then theta 2. Right? So this is x double prime, y double prime, and the angle between these two is theta 2. So what's the total angle here? The net rotation, this alpha is what? Theta 1 plus theta 2, right? So if I take any two of these matrices, right, and multiply them, I get a third matrix, which is of the same kind. What about the inverse? The inverse is just given by minus theta. Right, putting, if I put minus theta, I'll get the inverse of this matrix. Okay. So what I'm doing here, right, what these matrices are, they form a group, right? I've talked about groups before, right? I believe I've talked about groups. I asked you in the first quiz also, I think I asked you what. Did I ask you about groups? No? Priya, again, can you please remind me?
Yeah, but we know, sir.
Huh? Say that again.
But we know, sir, about groups.
You know about groups? Then why yeah. Don't you say something, man? I'm wasting my time telling you all of this. So what is a representation then? I can come straight to what is a representation if you know what are groups. Right? So a group is a set of elements which satisfies these properties, right? That the product of any two elements is in the same group. That there exists an inverse, which gives you the identity. The product of any element and the identity is the same element, right? This is a group. So rotations in two dimensions or rotations in three dimensions or in n dimension, they form a group, right? This group is labeled by as SO to SO 3 and so on. Okay. 2 stands for 2 by 2 matrices. 3 stands for 3 by 3 matrices and so on. Okay. Now, what does all of this have to do with angular momentum? Angular momentum is about rotations, right? So it should have something to do with the rotational symmetry of space. Just like linear momentum has to do with translation. So that has something to do with the translational symmetry. Now, so when we say that we have a group describes a symmetry operation, but it describes a symmetry operation on some object, right? So for instance, so by itself, in and of itself, this group element does not mean anything. It means something only when we say what does it act on. So for instance, I have this pen, this is my vector. Only when I say that, describe how does this group element act on this pen, like for instance, it rotates it from here to here, right? Or translates it from here to here. That is how I give meaning to this object, right? Otherwise, it's just an abstract quantity. So this pen, right? How do I describe this pen? So groups describe the action of symmetries on some space, right? So that the choice of your space and the choice of your action, they are related to each other. So for instance, if I have SO3, right, group of rotations in two dimensions or in three dimensions, I can say that my group acts on vectors. Okay. If it acts on vectors, then my action is given by these 3x3 matrices. Okay, but it is also possible to have a different space. Okay, it is possible to have a different space, which I'll just write as psi over here. And this action I'll just write as u. Right? So what can this psi be? Well, obviously the way I have written it, it represents some quantum state. And this u, because I've chosen letter u, it, well, the reason is because it corresponds to some unitary operator, right? So when I perform a transformation on my coordinate, this transformation should affect my wave function in some way, right? Because my wave function, if I write it in the position representation, it looks like this. So if I perform a transformation of my coordinates, psi of r and ket of r, these things should change accordingly, right? So what will happen to ket of r? Ket of r will go to ket of r prime, right? All of this inside the ket, because this is the position vector. Then the question is, how does psi of r change? Psi of r should also change in some way, right? It should change in a way so that this state psi remains the same. Because remember, changing the coordinates will not change the system, right? Performing a change of coordinates of my lab coordinates will not change whatever my system is sitting there, right? So if this changes, then psi of r prime should also change in some way, right? And so how do I describe how do I describe this change? Right? I describe this change in terms of some operator U. Right? So this change is described by, there is some operator U which acts on psi phi. Okay? Now, this is one kind of a state, right? This represents the wave function of a particle in real space. I can also have a different kind of state, such as that for a spin 1/2 particle, right? This is a spin 1/2 particle. What are these up and down states? These are eigenstates of sigma z, right? The eigenstates of sigma z with eigenvalue plus half and minus half. So if I change my coordinates, if r goes to r prime, then should that affect my sigma z, my definition of what is sigma z? Should sigma z also change to something else, right? And you would think that yes, it should, because what is this z? Z is refers to the z axis of your coordinate system. Right, so if your coordinate system is changing, right, if there is some rotation, it will change your z-axis also. Right, so your sigma z should also change. And your up and down, your concept of up and down should also change. Right, because this up and down spin is defined with respect to the original z-axis, right? When I perform a rotation, I will get a new z prime axis, right? And I can define a new set of up and down states. Let me call that up prime and down prime. So this is up and this is down, right? These are eigenstates of sigma z, and up prime and down prime are eigenstates of what? Are they going to be eigenstates of this original matrix sigma z? That's not possible, right? They are going to be eigenstates of sigma z prime. Right? But there should be some relation between these new up and down states and this old sigma z and the new sigma z prime. Right, there should be some relation between them. But now remember that this is a two-dimensional vector. These are two-dimensional vectors and these are 2x2 matrices. Right? Now if I have a three-dimensional vector, I know how to describe a rotation. A rotation is described by a 3x3 matrix, this object R. Right? So how do I describe the same rotation, right? But in terms of a 2x2 matrix. Okay. So I'm performing a change of coordinate, right? So R goes to R prime. And What this will also imply is that my up and down states will go to some new state, which I can write as U up and U down, right? But now this is a 3x3 matrix. What is this? This is a 2x2 matrix, right? Yes or no? Yes. It has to be, right? Because these are two-dimensional vectors. But they correspond to the same physical transformation, right? The rotation of the coordinates that the observer is performing. So once again, let me apply two different rotations. So let me go from R to R prime in terms of using one matrix R, var 1. And then I'll go to another coordinate, right? Right, so I'm doing the same thing that I did earlier. But now, how will my state change? When I perform the first rotation, there will be some 2x2 matrix, which describes how my state will change, right? And then there will be a second 2x2 matrix, right? So I'll get this transformation. Now remember that R2 times R1. So what are R2 and R1? R2 and R1, they are elements of a group, right? That's what I call them, right? And then when I take R1, R2 and R1, I get another element of the same group, right? But this language is incorrect. They are not elements of a group, okay? They are elements of the representation of a group. Right? They are elements of a certain representation. This representation acts on three-dimensional vectors. Similarly, U2 and U1, they are elements of a different representation of the same group. You can call that rep1 and rep2. So the product of U2, U1 is also an element of the different representation. But both of these R's and U's, they both correspond to the same abstract group element. So there is a single group element. There is a single group whose elements are G1 and G2. And G2, G1, the product of G2, G1 is again an element of that group G. So what is this R2 and R2, R1 and U2, U1? Now they look like different objects, right? These are 3x3 matrices. Right? These are 2x2 matrices. But they seem to have the same sort of behavior, right? The same relationship. So what we say is that these matrices, they form a representation of the group G. So the R matrices, right, the 3x3 matrices, they form a three-dimensional representation of G, of the group of rotations in three dimensions. And what about the U matrices? They form a two-dimensional representation of G. Right? So the picture is the following. I have some group which has some group elements. There is some space on which these group elements act. So I have some, let's say I have some vector space. The action of these group elements on the vector space is given by some set of matrices R. Right? So together this forms a certain representation. This collection of these matrices and this vector spaces is a representation of the group. But I can have a different vector space. Right? I can have a different vector space. Now my vector space is what? It's the space of states. Remember, that is also vector space, right? And this group of unitary operators acts on that state. This is also a representation of G. Okay, so you can have many representations of the same group. Right. And as I said, this is a bit of an abstract idea. So, well, if you don't quite understand it, then things make a lot more sense. Okay. So how does this, again, coming back to angular momentum, what does this have to do with angular momentum? In three dimensions, I have this set of operators, Lx, Ly, and Lz, right? These operators, they act on what? They act on functions, f of r, right? Then I have a two-dimensional 2x2 matrices. What do these act on? These act on two-dimensional vectors. Right? And actually, I'm not being technically correct. So this f of r, these are what? These are infinite dimensional vectors. So this Lx, Ly, and Lz that I have given you before in terms of r cross p, this is an infinite dimensional representation of the rotation group. This is a two-dimensional representation of the rotation group. Then we can write down another set of matrices, which are 3x3 matrices. These matrices act on three-dimensional vectors. All of these are different representations different reps of the same group of G. Okay. So let me again give you sort of a table. This is the dimensionality of my vector space, two dimensional, three dimensional, and infinite dimensional. And what are my vectors? What is my vector space? Here, these are up and down states. In the three-dimensional case, they are the coordinates r of a point. And in the infinite dimensional case, they are some functions of r. What are the operators which act on these states? In two dimensions, sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, and sigma square. In three dimensions, now I haven't told you what these matrices are yet, but I'll tell you in a second. And in infinite dimensional case, what are these operators? Lx, Ly, and L. And what are these? These are 2x2 matrices. These are 3x3 matrices. And these actually you can think of as infinite dimensional matrices. Right? Because they act on an infinite dimensional vector space. It's like the momentum operator or the position operator. Right? The momentum space and position space for a free particle, those are infinite dimensional vector spaces, right? But what is common about all of these? They all obey the exact same group algebra. What is that group algebra? It's the following, right? Li, Lj. This is the group algebra, but exactly the same relationship is obeyed by the sigma matrices and by these J matrices, which I haven't defined yet. Right? So they all obey the same relationship, right? So in all of these cases, you can define these raising and lowering operators, sigma L plus and L minus, right? So L plus minus is what? Lx plus minus Ily. Here I would get sigma plus minus is what? Sigma x plus minus I sigma y. Here I would get j plus minus is equal to jx plus minus jy, right? These are my lowering and raising states. How would L plus and minus act? And then I would have an L square operator. Right? L square is Lx square plus Ly square plus Lz square. Here I'll get sigma squared, which is sigma x squared plus sigma y squared plus sigma z squared. Here I'll get j square. Right? And again, these operators, these squared operators will commute with all of the individual x, y, and z components, right? And what about the states? You can define states. You can define states. You can label them in terms of the eigenvalues of what? Of L square and LZ. Right? L square and LZ. You can do the same thing here. You can label a state by eigenvalues of sigma squared and sigma z. But in this case, it's this is a little trivial because sigma squared is just the identity. So this basically corresponds to saying that L is equal to half and M is equal to plus minus half. And here you can label the states once again by in the same way and what are the restrictions here? In the first case, L goes from 0, 1, 2, 3. To infinity, and for each L value, M goes from minus L to plus L in steps of one. In this case, L is a fixed value. L is just 1/2, and M takes only two values, minus 1/2 and plus 1/2. That's it. In this case, this corresponds to L is equal to 1. And M takes three values, minus 1, 0, and plus 1. Right? And what is the dimensionality? The dimensionality here is infinite dimensional. Here, it's two dimensional. Here, it's three dimensional. And all of these are the representations of the same group. Now, I don't know if how many of you are actually following any of this. I hope you are following some of it. And now I told you that I would explain what these J matrices are. So let me tell you what these J matrices are, okay? The form of these matrices is very simple, actually. What do Jx and Jy and Jz represent? They represent rotations around the x, y, and z axis, respectively. Okay? Now, what is the rotation around the z-axis in three dimensions? R, z, theta. What is the matrix for that? The matrix looks like this. Right? This is a rotation around the z-axis in three dimensions. What is this jz? How is this JZ related to this RZ? Right? So these objects I've called operators. Right? I've not called them group elements, I've called them objects. But this is a group element. How is this group element related to the operator? First, I'll write down the answer and then I'll tell you how you get that answer. So this is that the operator JZ. This is of some parameter theta. This is our IX imaginary. Right? So this is a 3x3 matrix. I take the exponential of this 3x3 matrix. I get another 3x3 matrix. Right? This gives you the relation between the operator J and the group element R. And what should be the form of this JZ? Well, I'll write it down and I'll leave the proof for you to work out. Zero. So this is JZ. So I'll leave it as an exercise. For you to explain how we get this matrix RZ theta from JZ, right? I mean, I've already given you the answer. It is the exponential, but I want you to sit down and work out that exponential and show that you actually get this expression. Okay. All right. I'll stop here for today. And I won't talk about angular momentum anymore. This is it. I'll stop here. But in the next classes, I'll talk about composite, remaining classes. We'll talk about composite systems. And then finally, we'll talk about entanglement, which is obviously a very important topic. Okay. All right. So any questions? Okay, I'll stop the recording in that case.